iText software is a global leader in PDF technology, and the code behind iText PDF library has existed for more than 20 years. Millions of iText users, both open source and commercial, spanning financial, public, government, and healthcare sectors, including many Fortune 500 companies. iText is a global company with offices based in Belgium, Singapore, and the USA. So let's talk a bit about what this presentation will be about. We are going to overview some techniques to reduce the size of already created PDF files, mainly focusing on preserving the visual appearance and keeping the data which influence the view of the PDF. PDF-A, PDF-UA, and etc. compatibility of the discussed methods is not covered, basically because this formats requires some additional data or may a bit conflict with the proposed techniques. And I wanted to additionally mention that these techniques are not for long-term preservation or archiving of the documents. So at least you shall make an additional things to the resulted file, as for long-term preservation, it's highly recommended to use PDF-A compatibility, and hence it should be handled too. Let's start with the basics provided by PDF specification. We can use streams compression by applying flate decode or LZW decode filters. Commonly, mostly it's flate decode, which is basically tells us that the content stream data is compressed by using the deflating algorithm, the same one which is used in zip archives. And actually, here is the reason why most PDF files are bad in adding them into the zip archives. Another two things is object stream and cross-reference stream. These things allow us to put PDF data, PDF structures into the PDF stream and apply stream compression over it. Now let's talk about the things in PDF structure which we can remove because they are not affecting the visual appearance, or probably try to remove. So obviously unused objects, the indirect objects which has no references on them in other places. Unused resources in page streams, so the resources which are not used in the content stream directly. But be aware about the resource inheritance in page three. The next one is the comments. Comments are definitely not affecting the visual appearance, but here we have to mention that file header and on a file marker are required comments, so be careful about them. Also duplicates. So if we have some duplicate indirect objects, then we can definitely replace one with another one and use only a single one. But here again, be aware about the object context. Identical objects might have completely different contexts, and hence merging them may be a bit, may affect the resultant PDF in an unexpected way. For example, unfilled forms, when they're empty, they might look similar or identical, but the merging of them produces a single form actually, so filling it in one place will affect all other places. Next, alternate images. If everything is okay and the viewer displays your image well, then alternate image do not use in its appearance. But again, it may affect the viewers which cannot open your image. Thumbnails and bookmarks, they are actually useful for navigation. But again, on the visual appearance, on the visual appearance of the document itself, they're not affecting. It can be cleaned up. And incremental updates. So they're adding some heavy on the document size and lets us to get the changes history of the document. But with removing them, we can save some space. Incremental updates not only used for changes history. For example, they can be used for multi-signed documents. Now, just a bit talk about structures which are not directly affect the appearance, but it's not recommended to remove them. First of all, text. Not affecting the visual appearance, printing the PDF will not have this text, but again, removing text removes accessibility from the PDF. So it's not recommended to do that. Optional content groups or layers. If layers are disabled by default, then probably we can remove them as we don't see them. But actually, this will result with losing some data from the PDF. For example, optional content groups may be used for some localization of PDFs. And also annotations. Some annotations are not affecting the visual appearance. Others affect them. So for removing the annotations, it's better to consider the flattening and then removing the annotations themselves. By flattening, I mean the operation which putting the appearance of the object directly into the page's content stream. So for example, any forms can be flattened with drawing them directly in the page. And some different transparent objects which are overlapping one over another, we can flatten them into a single one or even into the page content stream. Now let's talk a bit about the content streams themselves. So how can we reduce their size? Simple optimizations such as operators which are not affecting the appearance, for example, setting font without showing text, subsequent text positioning, again without showing text, subsequent color operations, etc. Here in the top you can see some examples of such cases. Then invisible or overlapping content. Again, here is an example, we can see two rectangles, the second one completely overlaps the first one, so the first one can be safely removed. Inline image extraction, for cases when we have the same image presented on several places as an inline image, we can extract it as an imageX object and use the do operator, which we can probably have seen already on previous presentations, to draw a single object onto different pages. And another a bit complex approach is content stream operations reordering. So for some cases, we can reorder all the existing operators which will allow us to remove some space, to save some space. For example, here we have two rectangles with the same two rectangles passes with the same color and fill operation operator, so we can combine these passes and save a bit space here. Now let's talk about images. So in PDF file, the image is presented either in a raw format or in a compressed one. The raw format is basically a bitmap in a stream, in PDF stream, with additional PDF structures defining how this bit stream should be treated, such as color spaces, width, etc. While the compressed image in PDF is almost the raw compressed format, such as JPEG, JPEG 2000, etc., with markings that the PDF has this compressed image. So as the first optimization technique, we can convert the raw image, the bitmap stream, into the lossy compressed one. But this operation is not always straightforward as it looks like, because as I already mentioned, for raw images, the PDF color spaces are affecting the meaning of this bitstream, and hence we have to preserve it when converting to the compressed format, but not all of the PDF color spaces are easily to be converted. If continue talking about compressed image in PDF already, we can definitely reduce the image quality by increasing the compression rate. And again, this would definitely affect the appearance, but it's based on the compression rate you would apply. So if we have some image which would be reducing its size when applied on a viewer, and the compression rate is not high enough, we can win some space, but without losing any appearance, actually. Now let's talk a bit about raw images format. First of all, we can reduce the image resolution. It's quite simple operation, as we operate only with the bitstream itself. There are a lot of different algorithms which allows us to reduce image resolution, such as downsampling, subsampling, bicubic downsampling, and all others. when applying this change, keep in account the final scaling on the PDF page. So as I've already mentioned, if the image which is contains in the PDF would be downscaled when applying it to the page, almost for all cases we will not see any appearance changes, but if after this rescaling we'll get an upscaled image, it would affect it quite dramatically. And the ideal resolution for an image would be the one when we not need any downscaling or upscaling when drawing the page. Some steps about the image colors. So colors conversion, one of the most, I think, simplest cases is grayscaling of an image, I mean the raw image. This would definitely affect the appearance if we have a high colored image, but if we have an image with all equal color components, I mean already grayscaled, then we can grayscale it on a low level with replacing the color space and reducing the bitmap size. Another compression is four components to three components color space conversion. Here, appearance may change. Again, for some different viewers, it may result with changes, and it highly depends on the device on which you would look at your PDF, but it may be work for you here too. Also, as mask images with meta entry allows us to merge meta entry into the image itself. Generally, detailed discussion of color spaces is a separate topic, so let's continue. Another approach for images compression is OCR, optical character recognition. So imagine the scanned paper or an essay where a lot of pages here, and during scanning, when you're not applying an OCR, you would obtain a PDF with a lot of images in it, and it's quite heavy PDF, actually. So for such cases, replacing an image with text may win a lot of space, actually. Moreover, if it's it contains some graphics, these graphics can be replaced with the smaller images with base text. But keep in mind that some PDFs may contain text written via graphics for on purpose, for example, for security reasons or to prevent text extraction. Now, let's continue with fonts. So fonts, starting with subsetting of fonts. Font subsetting is a PDF specification mechanism, allows us to not embed the full font file into the PDF, but rather embed its partial content, which contains the data for glyphs which are used in PDF. So for example, if we have a huge font with thousands of glyphs there, but using only 100 of the glyphs from this font, we can subset it and reduce the font file size. This operation is a bit unsafe for fonts used in forms without flattening these forms, in forms with the user input text. One of the results here is when we're applying this subsetting and then the user takes your PDF, trying to type some text there, but using glyphs, using characters for which we don't have glyphs in this subset, that may produce an unexpected behavior in appearance. Then several cases of fonts merging. Identical font files can be merged into a single indirect object, definitely, as this is about font descriptors in PDF with the same link to font file. Identical fonts with different encodings, we can apply some encoding mapping and replace the encoding for the second font such that it would be the same as the first one, and then replace it. Subsets of the same font, the slide before I've talked about subsets, so if we'll have subsets of the same font, we can try to merge them. But here it's quite hard to determine whether the two subsets belong to the same font and or to the same font and the same version of the font. Let's continue with fonts replacing. So again, some font structures can be replaced. For example, two-byte encoding with one-byte encoding replacement. Fonts replacing themselves, it's about visual similar fonts. So for if we have several fonts which are quite near to each other on appearance level, then we can try to replace them. For such case, there are a lot of, probably not a lot of, but there are some classifications which allows us to detect whether fonts are similar or not. For example, PNOSE classification, etc. Moreover, we can compare these fonts not by all its glyphs appearance, but only by glyphs which are presented in the PDF to increase the potential matches. Again, this operation may change the visual appearance. Depends on the precision which the classification algorithm gives us and the fonts which will be used. Another case here is removing embedded font files for standard PDF fonts. So as specifications tell us, the corresponding readers may should have an ability to show characters for standard fonts. So probably we can remove them. It may a bit affect the appearance in different viewers, but the separation also affects that we are losing PDFA compatibility at all, even if it was there. Okay, so about the techniques, that's all I want to share. Now a bit about ordering of these techniques if you would want to try to apply several of them. So what I'm suggesting is to start with flattening, flattening forms, flattening inline, flattening transparent objects, etc., to ensure that PDF's content streams contains all the data it would at the end. Then continue with content streams cleanup, not only ordering but also overlapping, etc., to ensure that all resources which are not be shown on the page would be removed from content streams. Continue with optimizations for images and fonts, and then cleaning up redundant PDF structures and applying the compression at the end. Several notes on the topics about. First of all, it's most of the significant site optimizations usually come from images and font resource optimizations, at least for the PDFs in the wild. And for each of the technique, it's worth checking the size change after any step, because some steps may produce heavier files than it was before the operation. For example, images after compression may take more space than the original because of the tool which you're using may add some metadata, or even with low compression, size may be quite near to the original bitstream size. And some steps may produce little profit with significant decrease in appearance quality. Again, returning to images, some high compression rates may not give the profit you're expecting for, but the appearance would be changed quite hard. That's all I wanted to share with you. One last thing is the link where you can try to optimize some PDFs and have a look at how it would be changed at the end. And that's all from me. Thank you.